Yeah, first, thanks for the opportunity to present the Human Brain Project to you today, and also I have a second slot after this to introduce a little bit neurobotics. So for everybody who was expecting Cecilia to give the talk, she's probably very busy preparing the next flagship on robotics, so I had to jump in relatively short notice. So I have the very unusual honor that I give the first talk, and I also, so the first talk of the conference and also the last talk before the coffee break. Yeah, and if I lose my voice throughout the next 1.5 hours, so please forgive me. So obviously I have two slots here, and I'm going to be talking about neurobotics already in the HBP part quite a bit. So in the second part, what I'm going to be doing is I'm actually giving a lecture that is from the EPFL curriculum. It's going to be in a MOOC. It's an introductory on neurobotics, and it goes a little bit more into the role of learning and synaptic plasticity in closed-loop systems from a very practical perspective, let's say. Yeah. So maybe just to give me an idea who you are, so can everybody who is longer than 1 year in the Human Brain Project please raise their hands? Longer than 1 year, okay? Who is not in the Human Brain Project? Ah, okay, so who is less than 6 months? Also a few. Okay, so it's a mixed audience, so I'm not going to bore everybody to death now, because certainly who has been around with the HBP for a while will know a lot of the things that I'm going to say now. Yeah, so for those, please relax. Okay, Human Brain Project is it's a 10-year project, and I'm going to talk a little bit about the history of the project and why it actually came about and what is the purpose. Yeah, and the EU, they always like to talk about disruption, disruptive tools, disruptive technologies. Interestingly, this adjective seems to turn into something positive. So disruption means to disrupt the usual way of doing things only if it was bad. Yeah. So if you do things usually and you are disrupted, then you get annoyed, like alarms on your phone or your computer. That's not a disruptive technology, but rather things like a mobile phone is a or a smartphone is a disruptive technology, because it enables new innovation. And now the EU set out a few years ago and said, what can we do in information and communication technology to spark new innovations? And that was the birth of the idea of a flagship. That is, the EU said, we're going to invest a whole lot of money into very focused areas to accelerate the research and also accelerate Europe as a place for science and innovation on the global landscape. So that was the idea, and the Human Brain Project started with the premise that there have been a lot of advances in brain research, starting with the first microscope in the 16th century, then you have Nissl staining, electron microscope, and so on, and then somewhere in the early 2000s, you had the start of the Blue Brain Project, and the question is, what comes after that? Yeah, and the answer, of course, is maybe we need something that brings together the two different approaches that are outlined here. On the top, we have all the different measurement technologies, from the microscope to MRI imaging, and down there we have computing as something that has advanced as well, and maybe it is time to bring these two worlds together. And this is the foundation premise of the Human Brain Project: use information technology to accelerate neuroscience. And I'm going to bore you with a few numbers to start with. Yeah, so what this says here is transformation into European research infrastructure, and this means ramp-up phase. And the EU is... that's getting better. No, it's not. Okay. Yeah, don't worry. Yeah, so the EU set out and said, okay, we want to fund whatever it is we are funding for 10 years. And 10 years is a long time when it comes to EU, and they actually don't have the money to give you over 10 years. So what they did is they cut the 10 years into different phases. The first phase was called ramp-up phase. It started in 2013 and ended in 2016, and we are now in a phase that is called operational phase, and even that phase here, as it's not as indicated here, one long stretch, but it's also cut up into different funding periods. The next funding period will actually start in April. And what is the HBP doing? I will talk to you later, but first I give you some numbers. So it's a 10-year project. The original roadmap was 1 billion euro. Yeah, this is a figure that that the media always circulated. The idea was 50% core projects, 50% partner projects. So currently, we are more like that. We are more in the ballpark of just having this 50% from the core project, which makes it 500 million over 10 years. Which is, if you look at the funding, for example, in Germany, for some of the larger institutions, or even the EPFL has an annual budget of 1 billion Swiss francs. Yeah, so that puts it a little bit into perspective. So a billion sounds like a lot, but if you distribute it over 400 scientists, 116 institutions in 19 countries, it actually evaporates pretty quickly. And the idea, the main goal is to build a so-called research infrastructure. And I will try to give you a more concrete idea about what that means. And what is this research infrastructure for? It is for acceleration of brain science or different branches of brain science. So one is neuroscience. Accelerated neuroscience, why should it be accelerated? Because we have lots of data that we are collecting. And the question is, what are we actually going to do with that data? And here the promise is, if we can integrate that data so that we know exactly what we have, which data is useful, which is not so useful, we can integrate that into computer models and simulations. And computer models and simulations interpreted as a next level of data, in the sense that you have in a model, everything put together in addition with the time domain, that is the dynamics. I will try to explain that in a bit more concrete way later on. Then accelerated medicine contribute to understanding, diagnosing, and treating diseases of the brain. Now the question is, how do we do that, or how are we supposed to do that? Here the starting point of the discussion is that a lot of very interesting data is actually resting in hospitals, and they are not accessible to medical research because they are essentially on the hard drives of doctors' clinics and so on. And the guiding question here was, maybe it is possible to make that data available while still maintaining or respecting patient privacy concerns to accelerate medical research, and also to go away from a purely symptom-based diagnosis to one that is more objective on objective criteria. Right now, the medical branch of the Human Brain Project is undergoing kind of a renovation. There have been open calls, that is, new groups are coming in. So I'm not going to really talk about this part here. Also, I'm not a medical doctor. The third part is accelerated future computing. And here the idea is we want to learn from the brain how to build algorithms and computers of tomorrow. We are living in an age where AI and deep learning are the buzzwords of the age. Yeah, we also have a lot of claims about AI, many of which, at least from my perspective, I always think if only they were true. The main criticism, however, from a understanding of the brain point of view, however, is that deep learning and all these algorithms, they go back to the knowledge of the brain from the 1950s. It is basically taking the 1950s knowledge of brain science and then putting another 50 or 60 years of engineering research on top of it. And the hope is that by putting another 60 years of brain science into that, we can actually do much better than we can do now with AI and with learning. And the same is true for building robots and computers. So there's a lot to be learned from the brain as a computing architecture, and there's also a lot to be learned from our bodies as robot models. Yeah, both in terms of performance, endurance, and energy consumption. Now, all this is implemented by a terribly complex structure of sub-projects, co-design projects, blah, blah, blah. Yeah, so I'm not going to talk about this. Rather, I'm trying to focus on the different areas of research that the Human Brain Project is pursuing, and not so much on the organizational point. This is a slide that I took from our more policymaker-related presentation, so I'm not going to explain that in detail. Rather, I'm going to what Katrin Ammons, the scientific director of the HBP, calls productive loops through multi-scale brain modeling. Yeah? And what we see here are basically two axes that are kind of shown in 3D. It's actually one axis. So we have here the nanometer scale, which is where we have proteins in our brain, up to the meter scale, which is the scale of our own body or our environment, and there are 9 orders of magnitudes in between, and the brain basically is interesting at all these orders of magnitudes, and ultimately understanding the brain means that we have to bring all these spatial scales together, and this is meant by multi-scale brain modeling. And what are the productive loops? The productive loops are branches of research that work together based on some enabling technology. For example, we have this medical informatics platform that is the platform that allows or is supposed to allow access to clinical data to researchers. So clinical studies can be performed here. This is one of these loops. Then there is what is called a brain simulation platform, and here we can study whole brain activity based on data, based on MRI studies, but also based on simulations. We have biomechanics and behavior, that's the neurobotics platform, and then again the brain simulation platform here, neural morphologies and neural physiologies, and that happened at different scales here, that's why this is shown like this. So we have the word platform appearing here a couple of times. So what are platforms? That is a platform. Yeah, it's an oil platform. But in the terminology of the HBP, platforms are internet-accessible research tools. And there are 6 of them. Some of them are visible to normal users, and some of them are under the hood and help you to do things. And I'm going over these different platforms, explain you what they are. So the main idea of these internet-accessible research tools are that they allow collaborative research on the brain and on brain-inspired computing. So you log into a central portal, and from there you can access various specific research tools. And this is a URL where you can go to, and you can get an account there, and then you can log in. And basically, the dream is that eventually you will have something like an online version of MATLAB or Python, where you can then access neuroscience data, neuroscience models, and bring everything together. How is that supposed to work? There's an ecosystem of these platforms. And at the center of these ecosystems are so-called scaffold models that integrate different strands of data. For example, neuroscience data, mainly about the mouse currently, they allow us to build models of brain circuits in rodents, but also whole brain models. And by starting first with the mouse, where you can do a lot of genetic manipulations, the hope is that you gain enough knowledge, general knowledge about the brain, that you can transfer some of that to human brain modeling. But of course, there is other information needed. Then medical data informs the human brain models. And from brain models, we want to learn for future computing. This is what I explained. And also, you want to learn for and from what we call in silico behavior, in silico behavior and cognition. That is, by taking brain models, giving them a body, having them exposed to a dynamic environment, you also can validate your brain models, but you can also advance your brain models. And you can try to make abstractions that you can then apply to robots or other control problems. And incidentally, this picture here translates into the different platforms that are implemented in the Human Brain Project. So at the center is what is called a brain simulation platform. That is a collection of tools and services to build brain models or neural circuit models at various levels of abstraction, starting from very detailed single-cell models to rather abstract circuit or whole brain models. Then neurobotics takes these brain models and closes the action perception loops. That is, we take the brain models, we add sensors, we add actuators, we add a body and place that in a dynamic environment to have the models actually, or the brain models actually back into their natural habitat, which is a body, ultimately. Then there is what is called a neuroinformatics platform, which collects neuroscience data that is collected by other researchers in the HBP, but also collected by other labs in the world. For example, the colleagues in the US from the Brain Initiative, they're producing a lot of interesting data. What we are working towards is that if you build a brain model in the brain simulation platform, you can inform these models, you can constrain these models directly by accessing the databases here in the neuroinformatics platform. So instead, I mean, I don't know how many of you are neural modelers. Can you raise your hand? Who has ever done a neural model? Okay, not too many. So a few hands are going up. So typically what you do if you build a model, you look up the equations and then you go through the search for the parameters for your models that describe roughly the cells that you want to describe. And that is a very tedious hunt. And by collecting all that information, this becomes much, much easier. I will try to give a little bit of an idea how that works in practice later. Medical informatics platform, I said already, this is undergoing a revamp, so I'm not talking too much about this now. Finally, computing. There are two aspects of computing here, which are hardly readable. So one is called high-performance analytics in computing. So high-performance analytics is the aspect that you have massive amounts of data here, and these massive amounts of data, they need to be analyzed if you want to build models out of it or if you want to obtain knowledge out of it. And that requires tools and infrastructure to store that data, but also to run analytics on that data, preferably on supercomputers. So one of the sub-projects in the Human Brain Project is devoted to providing us, the rest of the project, and also other researchers with the tools and infrastructure to do these types of analysis, so that from a convenient web front end, you can run analytics on large data sets and you don't have to worry about the nitty-gritty details of how to deploy such a analysis request on a supercomputer, for example. The second part of computing here is what is called neuromorphic computing. You can hardly read it here, unfortunately, due to the contrast. So neuromorphic computing is the idea that you build chips that mimic how the brain works. And I will show that a little bit in one of the future slides. Basically, the idea is that you try to mimic the parallelism that you have in the brain. So if you look at our brain as a computing device, it consists of many, many neurons. And these neurons, they are not clocked by a central clock like your CPU clocks the memory cells, but rather each of these neurons is operating independently. And they're sending each other little messages. So neuromorphic hardware tries to mimic that and also tries to achieve another very interesting feat of the brain, namely that the brain operates roughly on 15 to 20 watts of power. Yeah? So you have a supercomputer up in your skull. It's very small, very compact, and it runs on very little energy, while computers you can buy, and even the supercomputers, the best supercomputers of today, they fill entire sports halls and require, I'm exaggerating a little bit, half a nuclear power plant to be run. Yeah, and 50% of that is for cooling them. And of course, computer industry is very interested in learning how to build very compact, very energy efficient computers, and the brain is the ideal blueprint here. And then I'd like to mention also our education program, thanks to which we are all here today. Yeah, so the lectures that are presented now in the following days, they are collected, they're available from the education program website, and by this, the Human Brain Project is also building a curriculum for HBP-related science, and even, like many people do, even if not everybody shares all the ideas of what is done in the Human Brain Project, still a big impact comes just from collecting the knowledge and also disseminating the knowledge in terms of lectures and courses and so on. And now I would like to go over the different platforms in a bit more detail, starting with the neuroinformatics platform here. So there are different components which are linked together, and they're all accessible from the central collaboratory, from the central website. So there's a data space, a knowledge graph, various brain atlases, and a knowledge space. And basically, these are all aggregations of different data sets curated and prepared in such a way that they are accessible for you via the web, but also there is an application programming layer, so-called APIs, that allow you to write your own applications, your own programs that automatically query and extract data from this central database. So this is one example here. This is a brain atlas builder. This is done by Jan Bjarli's group in Oslo. And it's probably best if you just go there and have a look. It allows you to look at brain models with different annotations. So you can see the individual brain areas. You can highlight specific regions. You can highlight specific cell types and so on. You can look at the original data sets that underlie the different staining pictures. Here, for example, you have a whole brain Golgi stain. You can zoom in into a high degree of detail, and you see the individual cell morphologies. So this is the web user interface. And as I said, there is also an API to actually pull the data out programmatically. Similarly, there is a human brain atlas that allows you to go through the human brain with similar precision. This is generated under the leadership of the research center in Jülich, Katrin Ammons' group. And Now the brain simulation platform, there the idea is that you bring the data together and you turn it into models that you can simulate. And that starts with experimental data gathering. Then you have the individual cell morphologies, and they are actually placed back together in 3D to give you circuit models which can be simulated. And then you validate the models by doing the same measurements in the simulation that we do in an experiment. You compare, then you do a so-called refinement step where you take the knowledge that you get from running your from comparing your experiments with the simulations, and then you refine the models, and basically you run in a constant modeling refinement loop so that the models get better and better. And I will try to elaborate that a little bit. There was a publication 2 years ago, 3 years ago by now, in Cell that outlined precisely how that workflow works. So here you see a web page for of the so-called NMC portal, so neocortical microcircuit portal, where you can get all the information about the circuit, how the cells are connected, what types of cells they are, what electrical properties they have. And so this portable is accessible from the HBP website, but also from the BlueBrain website at EPFL. Yeah. And basically, it's a repository that gives you not only the simulations, but also access to the individual pieces that contribute to the simulation. And finally, there is a whole brain modeling, and I will talk a little bit about that. And here the idea is that you automatically ingest data sets from various imaging techniques and turn them into a simulation of the whole mouse brain or other species if you have the corresponding data available. So what you've seen so far, of course, is just looking at the cells and the neurons in the brain. But what if you ultimately want to understand, for example, how brain diseases come about, how you can treat them with drugs, you have to understand how the brain metabolism interacts with the neurons. And this is another branch of research that is going on, namely a digital reconstruction of the glial vascular system. So here you see the vasculature of a piece of brain tissue. So these are all the tiny blood vessels. And the area that you see here is roughly the size of an electrode that would go into the brain if you do an electrophysiological recording. And the current research that we are doing in Geneva is combining the placement of cells in a microcircuit model with the placement of glia and the vasculature so that we can study their interactions. The high-performance analytics and computing platform, I mentioned that already, it provides basically the infrastructure layer on which we can run the simulations and on which we can deploy the simulations on supercomputers that are situated in the various partners of the HPP. We have a large supercomputing center in Jülich that contributes the biggest resource. The second biggest is in Switzerland, in the Swiss National Supercomputing Centers, and there are two other locations, one in Barcelona in Spain and the other one in Seneca in Italy. And basically we have the simulation technology part, extending the functionality of brain simulation codes, numerical algorithms, and software technologies. Then data intensive supercomputing, this is what you need if you want to do scalable analytics of large data sets. Then interactive visualization, which is a very difficult problem. If you have a large scale simulation like that of a microcircuit or that of a whole brain, visualizing that data in a way that it is instructive for the researchers is very difficult. So this is also part of the high performance analytics platform. And then dynamic resource management, this is something that hopefully no user actually has to deal with, but it should be hidden from you so that you get these services provided automatically. So this is basically the layering diagram. This is the level where you typically are. So you program your simulations, they use parallel computing, you use mathematical tools and so on, data management, data provenance, basically all the buzzwords that you need to write an application on top of supercomputing, and then this is all the management, the core platform services that has to be provided to make that happen. So basically this sub-project is underlying the web infrastructure that we see from the outside. The medical informatics platform, I will skip for now, and I jump to the, for the various reasons, yeah, and I skip to the neuromorphic computing platform. There are two types of system developed in the HPP, and they have a long history. One is called Spinnaker, and one is called BrainScales. And I start with the Spinnaker system. The Spinnaker system is essentially a little chip where you have many processors on board, and these processors are optimized in a way that they communicate asynchronously via spikes, essentially, similar to a neural network. And the Spinnaker architecture is optimized for low power consumption, and yeah, you can efficiently run spiking networks on Spinnaker in real time, which is very useful for robotics applications. And it is still a digital computer, so the base technology here is what is called ARM. ARM is the type of processor that you have in your mobile phones. Most mobile phones nowadays have ARM processors. This is the same technology. It comes out of Manchester. BrainScales, by contrast, is an analog computer. It implements directly the dynamics of a neuron model as an electrical circuit. So rather than computing the equations of a neuron model, it implements it in physics. That is, it's not actually simulated, it's emulated, as I like to call it. And this little guy here can run or implements 512 neurons with 115,000 synapses. And now the trick is that you can scale that up. I think I have a picture somewhere here. So this is a BrainScale system. So it's obviously a big system where you have so-called wafer modules. A wafer, I don't have a picture here, is basically the big disk on which originally the circuits are printed. And in traditional technology, these disks are cut into small pieces and then individually packaged as little black boxes. These are the ones that you see if you watch a circuit board. But in the BrainScale system, they actually leave the whole wafer intact and just wire it up directly. And then they can build these machines that give you essentially an analog supercomputer for brain research. And a similar thing has been built by the groups in Manchester, where they wired up 500,000 cores. Here there's a little little movie that explains how that is done. This movie you can actually watch on YouTube, because it's actually not trivial to wire up a system like this. So here we have 24 frame boards. They're connected by 1,800 cables. So these are all the boards, and these are the cables. And now actually connecting this thing here is very difficult labor. So you have long cables, and you don't want to have them. So there is an algorithm which gives you an optimized packaging here so that you minimize the cable length. Now this is the animation. And then you have five racks where you place that in. And then you have a number of students who actually have to put that all together over the time of a few days. Yeah, so there are industrial coolers up here. So you have these 1,800 cables. They have to manually be connected. And they actually have their own software package installed so that the little LEDs that blink here tell these guys where they have to put the cable. And also, you will see that they're wearing headphones. And the headphones also give them instructions what to do next. So yeah, you have here three remote control students building up a brain model. So it takes three brains to build one. Or even, yeah, I don't know. Okay. Then the neurobotics platform, there the idea is that you can embed brain models that either run on a supercomputer or run on these neuromorphic hardware, and you give them back a body and place them in a virtual environment. I've seen that there are a number of talks from our friends in Karlsruhe and in Ghent going a little bit into detail, because I'm not going into detail. So I will talk a little bit about the neurobotics platform subsequently. But before that, I would like to mention that all the platforms that I mentioned so far, they are accessed through what is called the collaboratory. That's the central entry point. And we are not quite yet there yet, but this is the aim, that all these different platforms are so interlinked that you can exchange the data seamlessly between them. So what does the collaboratory look like? Again, we are a little bit lacking contrast, but you can try it out. Essentially, you have storage, you log into the web, you get a web front end similar to what you would get in Gmail or something like this. So there you have storage, but you also have the possibility to open something like a Jupyter notebook, for the geeks among you who know, and you can basically program your data analysis, your brain model, your neurobotics model, your neuromorphic model, all with the same tools, and exchange the data. You can invite people to your personal working space. It's called a collab, a collaboratory. So you can invite people, you can exchange, there's a chat, you can exchange messages, and it gives you all the tools that you need to collaborate with other people that are working with you. Yeah? So the collab is the name given to the collaborative workspace. You can make them public so that everybody can see them. You can make them private so that only you or restricted members can see them. So you have a fine granular way to control who's seeing what you do. So you can use them to publish documents. You can just use them as a kind of document editor or data repository. This is basically up to you. So there's a navigation bar here. These are the different pages. And then these pages can be filled, so you can also use it like a web editor. Here you have a chat area where you can communicate with your colleagues. And I would now explain a little bit in context how the different platforms are supposed to work together. So I'm starting again with this slide, which was one of my introductory slides here on accelerated neuroscience, accelerated medicine, and so on. And the first question is, what do we gain by integrating everything we know about the brain into computer models and simulations? And I will start with an anachronism in a way. So I will start with the first data integration process, a project of mankind, which is the first globe that was created in the 15th century. So I'm not an ICT project here, but rather it's very manual labor. So there was a man, Martin Beheim, he was a German, and he built the first globe. This is the very globe, it still survives. You can, if you are ever in Germany, you can visit it in Nuremberg. And at that time, 1492, the word globe didn't exist, so he called it Erdapfel, which is incidentally the German, or a German, lower German word for potato, yeah, for French, pomme de terre. This is what it literally means. It means earth apple. And in order to produce this globe, you basically had to collect all the data that you had about the brain, which is incidentally were just maps drawn, hand-drawn by people, merchants, travelers, and so on. And you had to kind of rescale them and order them and connect them to give you this coherent picture. Here you see the outline of Africa, which is actually rather good. If you go inside, you find a lot of nonsense about the animals and creatures supposed to live there. So what does this tell us? So it tells us that by just collecting this information, you get a consistent view of the knowledge of the brain for us, but of the Earth for Beheim. Yeah, so this is a drawing of the globe from the back side. You probably can't see too well back there. I can just explain you. So here we have again Africa, here we have Spain, and here we have England. Here we have an area called Katai, which is an old name for China. This little thing here is supposed to be Japan, even though it doesn't really resemble the islands of Japan. And here we have, I think it's supposed to be Polynesia, but there's something important missing here, yeah, which is the Americas. Also, so this is Google Earth rotated roughly to the same position as best as I could. Yeah, so here's Africa again, Spain, and so on. These are the Americas, and you see the scale is also not quite correct, even though the circumference of the Earth was relatively well known since the Greek times. But what you, I mean, the criticism that we often hear in the HBP about brain modeling is if you just simulate the brain, you're not learning anything. And this is, of course, a statement that can only come from somebody who's never tried it. Because even if I imagine Martin Beheim sitting there with all these maps, he will have had a pile of maps for Europe, yeah, and maybe some maps for Africa, but obviously he didn't have a single map for the United States, which means he didn't even know that he doesn't know that it is there. Yeah? But for other reasons, for other areas where he just had a few maps, he knew exactly there is something missing. And this is the same if we start collecting data for the brain. Just by looking at what is there, we know, for example, that we know a huge amount of things about the visual cortex. Yeah, it's probably the most studied area in the entire brain, the visual cortex. But if you go to other parts of the brain, some obscure nucleus in the midbrain, then you will maybe find a handful of scientists in the world that will get excited about this region. And it means if you want to build a whole brain model, if you want to understand the entire brain, then important pieces might actually be missing. So, yeah, what do you get by integrating data? Yeah, we get a consistent view where each piece of information fits into the global picture. And this is the important aspect. It's not about just having the different pieces of data sitting on one table. It is about bringing all the different pieces of data into context, like scaling, rotating, in this case here, in the case of a 3D structure like the brain, with different description levels and the different spatial scales, this is a much harder problem. And for the Earth, it took us 500 years to go from here to there. 500 years. And of course, in these 500 years, the technologies changed a lot. So Martin Beheim, in that time, you literally had to launch an expedition and a sea voyage if you want to find out something about a tiny spot here. Yeah, that's like single electrode recording in the brain. Yeah, this is kind of the equivalent. Now time goes on, and nowadays we shoot a satellite up and take a picture from the top. Yeah, this is similar to the MRI imaging techniques that we have nowadays, or calcium imaging, and all the techniques that give us basically a coherent view over a large area of the brain. Yeah, and that means that maybe we can also hope on the technology to progress. For example, I put great hopes into the American Brain Initiative to deliver better data so that we can build better models. Anyway, the question now is, what do we do with that data? We build models with that data. And what do we do with that model? We simulate it. Now people say you can't simulate the brain. It's true, exactly. That's why it's a research project. Yeah? So at one point you have to start doing it in order to know how to do it. You're not born with the capability of doing something. You always have to learn. And the learning process here is that we say we build a tool chain that turns data into models. And we actually accept the fact that these models will be coarse. So the emphasis is on automatizing the process of model generation, and then once you have a model, you can actually validate it. Yeah, I always tell my students a bad model is still better than no model, because I already made one step. I made the step that I have something that I can put to test against experiments. Whereas if I just say, oh, it's so difficult, oh, no, it doesn't work, oh, no, no, we don't have this data and we don't have that data, then you will never, ever get one step further. Yeah? So once you have a model, you can validate it, and the model better be wrong initially. Why? Because only then you learn. The worst case that can happen is, yeah, I mean, this is literally the worst case, and this is what the critiques are probably referring to. You put all the data together, you switch your simulation on, and it starts talking to you. Yeah, I mean, this would be worst case, because you literally haven't learned a thing. Yeah, you just put everything together and it works. But this is fortunately not how life is. Yeah, you start off, you start your model, and nothing works. And then you start figuring out why doesn't it work. And this is your validation step. And then you look out for new data, other types of data. Where is an abstraction wrong? And so on. And this is a process where you start learning. And you go basically in a cycle here. Yeah, so from step four, you put in new data sets to improve the model, and then you go back to step three. So you validate, and you continue and refine. This is how you progress. And the starting point was the mouse brain. Why? One reason is, from a modeling perspective, that the mouse brain is relatively small, but it's still very large in the perspective of what you need to actually simulate it. So we have 75 million neurons, roughly, and 10 to the 10 synaptic connections. If you translate that into a simulation, that's still a lot of data. And I will now explain a little bit how the different modeling strategies link together that we have. So I mentioned already the neocortical microcircuit that was reconstructed in the Blue Brain project. Here is again this different, the layering of the different scales that we have. And if we just go into the micrometer level here and look what we have inside, then we have different neural circuits. What you see here is a so-called cortical column. It's roughly 2 millimeter height and 0.5 millimeter in diameter here. And you have different properties that put together make up this dirty toothbrush, as you might call it. So you have ion channels that sitting on the cell membrane, the different cells, these ion channels give the cells electrical properties that we can measure. We can put different cells together, and that give us the properties, the electrical properties of a microcircuit here. How do we put these things together? That's a movie that you can find on YouTube. You've probably seen it a zillion times. So this is a cell morphology. This is actually reconstructed under the microscope. You can do that for many, many, many cells over many years, and then you can, in the computer, reassemble your dissociated tissue. And this is what you see here. And this is the first step in reconstructing a neural microcircuit. The space fills up here. And the morphologies, that is the shapes of the cells, they determine where axons and where dendrites can touch. And these are the positions where you can have a synapse. And since the connections between the neuron determine how the circuit as a whole will behave, this is crucially important. And that's why we need the morphologies of the cells. That is the exact shapes, whether they are stretching an entire column or whether they are localized in a small region. Here we are now flying through this little forest. This is actually diluted. It's just showing 10% of the entire circuit. There is no free space in your brain usually. I'm not showing the part where the synapses are determined. It is rather involved as well. And for each of the cells, we can also assign an electrical model, which then allows us to simulate the activity. So here you see that circuit again, and the color that is flashing now here shows you the membrane potential on this neuron on each of the individual neurons and how the activity propagates inside this layer here. We are now much further. We can do an entire somatosensory cortex. One interesting point here is that this approach doesn't scale. Yeah, so this approach of reconstructing a circuit required that you literally manually collect information of almost each and individual cell that you have in this case, a rat somatosensory cortex. What you rather like to have is, as I mentioned earlier, a toolchain that does it automatically for you. So the other approach is a bit more like the Martin Beheim approach. So you take different types of data. So for example, this is data from the Allen Institute, where you have Nissl stains with the corresponding annotation that tells us which part belongs to which brain region here. Then you have, so from this data, for example, you can determine where are the cells in the brain. And then there are viral tracer injection data, which at least at a macroscopic level tell us which which neuron or which brain area is connected to which other brain area. And we can collect several of these data sets and integrate them in what we call a high-D voxel database. And from that, we get a breakdown of what we find at each position in the cell. And now what can we do with this? We can, of course, look at it. That's nice. But what is nicer is that we can use it to build brain models. And this is on this slide here. So here we see the outside mesh of a mouse brain. These are these Nissl stains that we get from the Allen Institute. If we zoom in, we can see the individual cell bodies. And now we can turn the density of the cell bodies in a probability density of finding a cell there. And that gives us cell positions in the brain. And cell here literally means that it could be either a neuron or a glia cell or whatever. Yeah, and here we have an artificial Nissl stain compared to the original. And now we can take various genetic staining data sets that also exist. And they help us to tell us, help to tell the cells apart that we have so that we can turn an unnamed anonymous cell into a neuron or a glia cell. So we integrate that, and then on top of that, the connectivity. There are DTI, diffusion tensor imaging data, which we can use to determine the largest fiber tracks, but also viral tracer injections. The first thing here is the injection site, and this is a projection site. And what these tracers do is they infect the cells and jump exactly one synapse. And that tells us who a particular region is connected to. And by collecting many of these experiments, we can reconstruct the connectivity in the brain. This is, of course, a very, very coarse model. It lacks many, many data, but it allows us already to do validations against other experiments, other data sets that can be gathered. Yeah, and then out of this, we get simulations like this one here. So here now, every dot that sparks up is a neuron that is spiking. The color code here corresponds to the brain region. Here you have the cerebellum, olfactory bulb, cortex outside, and so on. So everything is there. But the actual problem now is that we have no idea what is going on here. Yeah, so this is a simulated brain, but can we really understand what is happening here? Probably not, because the brain is simply a brain in a vat. Yeah, it's completely detached from everything. So how about this one here? So there you have a little mouse with whiskers. I'm now going to touch the whiskers and you see something happening here. Yeah, and of course now we can start to understand what is going on. So a brain needs to be stimulated somehow, and it needs a body to do that, because all our sensors are somewhere located on our body, and likewise all our motors, they are determined by the body that we have, which gives us this little picture here. So if you want to understand the brain, you have to understand where it is living. Yeah? It is living inside a body. If you went into a zoo or into a natural history museum 50 years ago, you'd find an isolated tiger in a concrete cage. Yeah, it wouldn't really help you to understand why a tiger is like a tiger. Nowadays, you would like to see it in its natural habitat, and it's the same with our brain. You want to understand it in its natural habitat, which means you have to understand the so-called embodiment. Yeah, so you have a musculoskeletal system that helps the animal to move around. You have a spinal cord, which is actually part of the brain, which as brain scientists we largely ignore. Even the Allen Brain Institute started out with a spinal cord atlas of the mouse brain, and they never returned to it. You want to understand how your reconstructed brain models interact with the spinal cord to produce the movements, and likewise how the different sensors that you have across the brain actually deliver the correct spatiotemporal input that you would have. Yeah? So neurobotics means that you have bodies for brains and brains for bodies in a way, so that you have a body model, you have your brain model, you have your different senses, vision, hearing, smell, touch, temperature, vestibular, proprioception. Who knows what proprioception is? Hands up. Okay, who doesn't? Okay, if you close your eyes and you raise your hand, you know where your hand is. That's proprioception. It is the knowledge of where your limbs are in space. Vestibular system, you know, yeah, and likewise, there is a whole cascade of behaviors. It starts with individual muscle contractions over reflexes, so-called motor primitives, voluntary movements. It's relatively complex. For example, there's something like 20 muscles controlling your arm. So if you're reaching out, you're actually moving 20 muscles to articulate two joints. Yeah, so a two-dimensional movement is articulated by 20 muscles. And of course, in your motor cortex, you don't want to think about all the individual muscles involved here. Yeah? So there's some abstraction going on along the way. And this is done largely by your spinal cord. And how this develops, actually, is also a very interesting question. Now, we have our whole brain models here. And many of us, they are not really content with seeing blinking dots. They would like to see things like this. They would like to understand short-term memory, long-term memory. They would like to understand cognitive control, all the things that relate to brain function. Yeah? And what we want to do ultimately in the Human Brain Project is bring these worlds together. Yeah? That's also part of the multi-level understanding of the brain, bringing the more cognitive description of the brain with the more neural description of the brain together. Another thing is in silico neuroscience, as already mentioned, as iterative refinement of brain models. And this is a large part of the neurobotics platform, namely to allow the replication of an actual experiment. So here we have an experiment where a mouse has to move a lever. And it's a trained behavior, and it's a stroke recovery paradigm. But I'm not going to explain that in detail. Just the idea here, you have a physical experiment, you get a certain set of data, and then you replicate the very experiment in the simulation, and you get similar data. You look at the difference in the signals, and that you use to refine the models. And I'm now coming finally to the neurobotics platform a little bit and the workflow that we have. That is, you have an experiment that you compose out of a brain model, a body model, some environment, some task. The first step is that you have to bring the brain model and the body model together. This is what we call instrumentation or alignment. There is some coding and decoding. So here we have the little robot and we have a little brain, but you might also have a mouse robot and a brain. You have to define which sensors, which actuators you have, which brain regions you're interested in, and so on. And then you finally, when you've done the connection, you run the experiment. And the neurobotics platform gives you tools to make this workflow happen. The first tool that I would like to show is what we call the environment designer. So how do you build the world that your robot is supposed to live in? Yeah, so you see this is very photorealistic, very 3D, very nice. It all runs in your browser. You have pre-built components. It's a bit like an IKEA flat designer, yeah, only that you don't get furniture from IKEA here. And the whole thing is designed to a scale that you can look at. You can look at robot models, but you can also look at animal models. So you have the different pieces here. So this is a time lapse now, how to create an environment from scratch. There's a little robot standing there here. Now we blend over, and here we have created a little arena on which the robot then can operate. Why do we have all this stuff in the background? For example, if the robot model is supposed to do some visual processing, you would like to have a rich visual environment. All these objects here have physics attached, so that if you let them drop, they will actually fall down, and so on. Then the next tool that I would like to show is the robot designer. This is a plugin for a 3D modeling tool called Blender. And I'm not sure how many people are familiar with 3D modeling. It's a very tedious task, and it's even more tedious to make a 3D model into something that you can use in a physics simulation. And this is what this robot designer is supposed to do. It's taking the 3D appearance that you design, and you add the mechanical, the kinematic properties on top of that. And here I would like to use the example of our rodent model here. So you see the skeleton here, and what we can do in this robot designer is we can, for example, give it muscles by just drawing them on. Yeah, so in defining the properties, and then we can export that, upload that to the platform, and have the rodent robot connected to a brain. Yeah, this is again a time-lapse movie just to illustrate that this is not something that takes forever. Yeah, I apologize for the weak contrast. This is the way it is. And then finally, you have here the actual experiment. So this is this little mouse experiment that I was mentioning. It's actually here on the lab table, so we literally have a virtual lab. This is a replication of the exact same experimental apparatus that was used in the original experiment. And here the mouse is articulating this little sled here. If the contrast was better, you could see the muscles and how they're activated in the movement here. What we are currently working on, this is not yet finished, is the connection to the brain model. So right now, this is just the spinal cord. In a second, you see a little brain visualizer window opening up, but it's not connected yet. This one here, so it has very few neurons so far. You can display them either in their anatomical arrangement, or you can sort them by the role they play in the model. And then eventually the brain activity will also be displayed on top of that. And finally, I would like to stop with a video from the University of Ghent, where they put everything together and illustrate how the neurobotics platform can be used to develop a neural control model for a simple robot, and then translate it into the physical robot. And Gabriel is actually sitting there, so maybe you can stand up, Gabriel. And
yeah. So
okay, so I don't have to show it, yeah. So maybe, but Gabriel will tell you the detail, and he will probably cringe when I say what is seen here. Yeah. So just a little spoiler ahead here. Yeah. So. Okay, it starts with a nice introduction. This is, of course, this is done in post-production here, I guess. Yeah. So you could program the screen. So basically here the idea is you want to optimize a controller. Gabriel will tell you the details. So they have a cheap robot, which is called Tigrillo. It's hopping around. It has four actuated legs with springs. And if you have legs with springs, they're extremely difficult to control with traditional control methods. So that's why a neural network is actually kind of nice. So they actually use an evolutionary algorithm here to train a controller so that that's the platform version here, that it learns how to walk. Yeah. So there's a Google video out there that is hyped wherever, yeah. So Google AI teaches itself how to walk. Yeah, this is the same, only with less hype. So you get this silly walk collection here until finally you have something that is actually working. But the nice thing is, so this simulations, they run in the Neurobotics platform. You can completely script them, and then you can choose the best version. So this is the activity here of the spiking model that is finally coming out. And then, yeah, if you want to know the details, you have to wait for Gabriel's talk. Yeah, and then eventually we can see the translation to the physical robot. Let me see. No, it's already gone. Okay, so here, if you have more questions, but I think we now have a little break, and then, well, at least we do a little break of 5 minutes, and then I continue with the second part. Yeah, unless there are questions, of course, now. So I'm done with this part of the talk.